Why not? Welcome to the February 16th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First item on the agenda this evening is discussion and approval of the minutes of the previous meeting. Any comments from board members? Hearing none, may I have a motion? Mr. Emery?
I move that the minutes of the previous meeting be approved.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Minutes have been approved unanimously. Correspondence received in our packets. A letter from the Chief of Police in regards to Hemlock Hill. Notice of the Shoreland Zoning Workshop. Zoning News, December 1998. Planning Commissioner's Journal, Winter of 1999. Zoning News Newsletter, January 1999. Letter from the Public Works Director in regards to Hemlock Hill. Memorandum from our Town Manager in regards to the Town Farm Ordinance. And the Planning Board Activity Report of 1998. On the podium this evening, additional correspondence from R.F. Haffenreffer, the fourth, in regards to the development of the Tinsman Realty Office Building. Letter from Catherine Blake for Constance Reich, in regards to the Tinsman development. Letter signed by numerous town residents. The actual letter itself is unsigned. Addressed to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board on the proposed Hemlock Hill subdivision. A letter from Richard Cohen, addressed to the Assessing Codes and Planning Office, in regards to Hemlock Hill Road development. Any comments on this correspondence? Hearing none, the first article under old business, Tinsman Retail Building Addition, a request by Thomas Tinsman for site plan review of a proposed addition to the ERA Real Estate Office located at 349 Ocean House Road, Section 19-9, site plan public hearing. The applicant like to come forward. If the applicant could begin by just reviewing the project quickly. Specifying any changes made to the project since your last meeting with the Planning Board. When that is complete, we will open the meeting to the public hearing in regards to this matter.
Okay, my name is, can I move this up?
Yes.
My name is Tom Tinsman, and I'm the owner of the property at 349 Ocean House Road. In looking over our submission for this meeting tonight, we found out that there were some things that we didn't get put on there in time that we'd like to discuss. As far as some of the things that we've changed, we have altered the parking a little bit, but that's something I want to talk to you about. Really on a lot of changes to the original plan, we made some additions in terms of a site for the dumpster. We've included some floor plans for the building itself. One thing that's not on your plan but has been a suggestion by the fire chief is that the building be sprinklered. We will be sprinkling the building with a sprinkler system. And that will be put on the plans for next month. As far as the parking lot goes, we're still not happy with what we've submitted for plans on the parking lot. And I think I'm going to need a little guidance from the board on the parking lot itself. We are showing a shared parking concept for shared use with the different uses in the building. And we're hoping to get that approval to do that. But we also want a better flow with the parking lot. Right now we have a dumpster located on the plan that I would like to somehow locate somewhere else, but I'm looking for some guidance on that thing. I did have a question on the dumpster itself, since it's something that we're going to need there, is whether or not that can be located within the 15-foot side setbacks outside of the parking lot area. That would give us a better flow for parking, better than it is right now. And also on the plan that you have, it shows a chain link fence around the dumpster. We're going to be changing that to a stockade fence. That will be reflected on the next plan. One thing that got omitted by accident was we did have a lighting plan on the original submission, and we forgot to put that back in, but that will be on the next submission. And the handicap accessibility, we were going to show and meant to show how the access to the sidewalks would be incorporated in from the parking lot, and that did not get on the plan, so we'll be coming back with that also. The sidewalk in the front of the building, we've had some very good suggestions on how to incorporate that sidewalk for pedestrian use with the idea of preserving the trees that we currently have on the property. And our plan shows kind of a straight sidewalk along the front of the building. And we do want to somehow give a description of where the area will be that sidewalk will be, but to go out and actually field locate that sidewalk so that we can meander in and out around those trees so that we can preserve those trees. And at this point, in terms of signage, we do not have any plans for any lighted signs, any additional lighted signs on the property, which I know is going to be a question that comes up. Site distances will be put on the next plan. For some reason, those didn't get on this plan either. So we actually have a submission tonight that is not everything that we wanted to bring to the board this evening. Do you have any questions?
We will reserve our questions until after the public hearing.
Okay.
At this time, I'd like to open the public hearing. Anybody with an interest in this proposed application, feel free to come forward to the podium. Introduce yourself by name and address, if you would, please. And we will patiently wait. Seeing no one coming forward, I shall close the public hearing. Mr. Tinsman, you either have no enemies or no friends. That's none. Both. At this time, I shall open the application up for discussion by board members. Mr. Tinsman, or your engineer, you may wish to return to the podium. Mr. Emery.
Just a couple of quick comments. I think the motion is going to be to table this this evening, and I think special attention should be given to the comments in the packet from the town engineer. At the last meeting, there were questions about the layout of the parking lot in terms of doesn't appear to be any floating dimensions in the parking lot. And it's not clear from at least the layout plan that we have that all of these dimensions from front to back add up to whatever the depth of this parking lot is if it's triangulated. Unless 43 feet 10 inches, which looks like is the depth of the building, is there any slippage in that at all? The point was, I think we have a 15-foot minimum setback at the rear, and we have a 25 maximum setback at the front, and then the parking lot is a bunch of dimensions that are all added up that are minimums for all of the spaces, all the maneuvering lanes, and then at the very back of the building, there's only a 4-foot wide sidewalk. If for whatever reason this doesn't triangulate out to be those specific dimensions, usually it's a good idea to have some float in it. It appears to me that the only place it would be float would be in the depth of the building. We have, I've just skimmed some comments we had in front of us, one from the Heffenreffers regarding fill around the trees. If indeed the trees are intended to be saved, it's very careful that there's no significant fill or cut around the trees. Certainly nothing, I mean, plus or minus 6 inches will usually do it in terms of killing the trees. So I think when you come back with a plan, each tree that you're proposing to save should have a spot elevation existing and proposed adjacent to the base of the trunk, so that even for your own information, I just find that to be very helpful. You had mentioned some questions about discussing with the planning board the circulation in the parking lot. I suppose it's probably best to discuss how the numbers are calculated and whether or not you are going to have all of the spaces or you require all the spaces that you indicate on the plan. But with something like a coffee shop and maybe some of the other uses, it appears as though there might be some need to have interior circulation that allows cars to perhaps even one way, if people come in and they turn right and go behind the building, then take a left at the end of that lot where you now have the dumpster, and then swing out around and come back out the driveway. That would make a very simple one-way loop. I'm not suggesting that you angle the parking, because I don't think you have enough space to do that. Otherwise, you're going to end up with a dead-end situation where you have people come in, and by the time they figure out it's dead-end, there are other people backing out. I just don't think that's going to be a very customer-friendly way to approach this. And I think the town engineer mentioned in his comments just being sure that the parking spaces are perpendicular to the heads of the stall. For example, the ones on the left as you're going in, they're sort of angled toward the front of the property a little bit. They should actually be perpendicular to the head of the stall there for the circulation to work correctly. One thing I guess I missed in the last presentation, Tom, was this issue of the overhang in the back. Could you describe what's going on there a little bit for us? We don't have a rear elevation. We just have a side elevation that doesn't really show that clearly.
Okay. The idea for that is the wraparound porch that's going to wrap around from the front of the building, around the side, the north side, and then around the west side of the building, facing the parking lot. And the idea here is, as you can see from this depiction here, is to have an area that does stick out from the building primarily for use of people in the building to go outside and be able to sit outside when they're either there eating, or if someone's working out in the fitness center, they can go out and get some fresh air and be able to go outside and not be out in the element. And it doubled also as an aesthetically pleasing addition to the building.
Yeah, I don't have any qualms at all with it architecturally. I think it is quite attractive. It's just that the site plan indicates two, it looks like posts coming down between, one's adjacent to the handicap stall, well actually both of them are adjacent to a handicap stall. and there doesn't appear to be any sort of protection around those columns. There's not enough room there for a wider island or something. I just would caution you on two issues there. One would be snow falling off the roof onto the hoods and windshields of cars parked underneath there, and the other would be a car hitting one of those columns while there were people on the porch and ending up with a lot of people on the windshields of cars. But I like the design. I mean, there's other ways, you know, cantilevers or whatever. I'm not criticizing the overhang at all. I think it's quite attractive. What is the purpose of the sidewalk in front of the building that's 2 feet away from the porch, the straight sidewalk? Where does that go rather than just coming down the stairs and along the public sidewalk, so to speak?
That will be connecting with a sidewalk on the town property that will allow handicap accessibility to the second floor by entering in the front of the building.
Could you explain how that works?
Well, that was one of the things that didn't get onto the plan, but there will be a sidewalk over here on the town property. And what we're hoping is to be able to provide access to that from this handicap area onto that sidewalk so that they can come up to the front of the building and be able to go right into the second floor. And that will be on a grade that will allow that.
That's the way you're intending to meet the requirement for handicap. Have you determined, we discussed this at the last meeting, have you determined that there's a need to have handicapped access to the second floor of the building?
We want handicap accessibility to the second floor. We haven't really checked to see if it's a requirement or not, but it's something that we want.
And this plan is being reviewed by the State Fire Marshal's office?
Not that I know of.
Yes.
It is? Okay.
Because they also review for handicap or accessibility compliance, and that would seem to me to be a little bit of a circuitous route for an individual or you know, whether it's a wheelchair or someone with just had hip replacement surgery. In order to meet the standard for accessibility, it seemed to me that you would either have to have parking closer to the front of the building or you'd have to have an elevator within the building. So I think that's something that you want to be very clear with the State Fire Marshal's office. I like the idea of changing the dumpster enclosure to wood. It may work better in the back left-hand corner of the property, and we have those two spaces intersecting.
Right over
as long
there.
As it's, you know, those it would have to be picked up on off hours, but I think it works better there than adjacent to the school driveway. In reviewing the plan at the last meeting, we noted that there was quite a deep cut in the middle of the parking lot where those catch basins are proposed. And I think a very steep side slope between those. I think something in the order magnitude of 10%. That hasn't been changed with this submission, has it? The grading in the parking lot?
Yes, it has.
It has? Yes, you're correct. I'm sorry. The other thing that we mentioned at the last meeting is that the understanding is that the existing building will have the same treatment on the exterior that the proposed addition has.
Yes.
The drawings don't, I think they may be labeled as new shingles, but they don't have the same depiction. I don't know.
Right, it's not a drawing, but it's noted in the plan.
Okay. That's all.
Other members of the board? Yes, Ms. Nancy?
When you were designing the parking spaces, did you have any idea as to the number of people who would be showing up for the gym part of the building?
How many people will be showing up for that?
Yeah. I mean, there isn't a chance that it's going to be a pileup of cars in that parking lot, is there?
Could be. I mean, you know, there's no way to determine that. there's only so many people that you can fit into one, and being a member of fitness centers all my life practically, I can tell you that there's a gradual use and there's a couple of peak times. And those peak times will probably not coincide with the other uses in the building, specifically the real estate office, which is currently there. The peak times that are used in a fitness center will not be the times that are peak usage for the real estate office. They're typically after work or before work, and sometimes at lunchtime, but seldom at lunchtime. So I don't think that there's going to be a conflict of...
How many people do you think can be accommodated by the fitness area?
Hard to say. I don't really know.
Do you have a client lined up?
Yes.
For that?
Yes.
I'm just wondering if the parking is going to be adequate, let alone the difficulty of turning around and...
Yeah. Well, as with most businesses located in the town of Cape Elizabeth specifically, and probably everywhere in the state, you try to do what you can to accommodate the parking, but whenever you have a peak time of usage, you may have some problems with that. Now, people will learn what those peak usages are, and they will avoid those times. I do it myself. When I go to a fitness center, I typically pick the times that are off peak times so that I don't have to share the machinery with people. And I'm sure that's going to happen here. But with all the parking that we have at the high school, and I know that's one of the things on the agenda tonight, and I've been on that corner there for 10 years now, and I can tell you that there's many, many times where people are parking in illegally at the school, they're parking on the school road, on my property. They're all over the place. And I mean, that issue can't be addressed. The yoga place up the street, I mean, they park straight in behind each other. There's times there where if you're the first one in there, you can't get out until everybody's gone. The IGA shopping center, I mean, there's times there where you can't get into some of the businesses you want to use. Best intentions to try to get the right parking, and the concept that we've shown on the shared concept is the best that we can come up with in terms of the times that people will be using those. The apartments, typically those people will not be there during the day when the businesses are in session. And so we're trying to use that shared concept to try to maximize what we can do for parking. Now, one of the reasons that we don't have a couple more parking spots is that I'm trying to save some of the trees in the back so that we don't have a big sea of tar back there too. We could eliminate some trees and probably expand the parking a little bit, but I prefer not to do that. So we're doing the best we can to try to get as much parking in the back there without making it look like a sea of parking, and to have a shared use. And I can tell you that most of the people that will be using the fitness center will probably look for the off-peak times to try to not come there and have to wait for machinery or fight for parking. But I can tell you, from my standpoint, it'd be awful nice to look out and see a parking lot full of cars, because that means people are actually using the facility. And that's
what would the overflow go?
They'll probably come back later. I don't know. You know, I don't envision an overflow. It's possible.
Mr. Wilcox.
Yeah, I have a question, Mr. Tinsman. You said that you wanted to conserve some trees and that you would rather not eliminate trees and expand parking. But don't the plans right now show paving right up to the setback limits in the town center ordinance on all three sides of the property?
On my plan?
Yes.
Yeah.
So you've already expanded the asphalt as far as you can.
Mm-hmm.
Is that not true?
Yes.
One of the areas that also came across our desk tonight that I was kind of interested in is there is a sort of a row of mature pine trees right now going down the school drive, and I can envision a very nice sidewalk along there also, and your letter was very helpful in talking about that. But at the same time, if the grading plan in that area creates a sort of a 100-foot gap in those pine trees, which are on town property, not on your property, because you've undercut the root systems in through there, I think that would be kind of unfortunate in terms of the sort of nice approach to the high school that's there right now. And when I asked last week if you had permission to do the work on that on the property there, I appreciate the letter from the town manager saying that the town likes the idea of the sidewalk. It's a very positive, I think, impact on the town. But I'd be interested further in finding out if the abutter in this case would give you permission to destroy the trees.
Oh, I won't. I won't do that.
Because you might be able to do something creative with a stone wall or a retaining wall in that area and have the trees and your site grading that you want.
I don't understand. What would a retaining wall do? I mean, it's all level grade. There isn't any slope there.
Well, you're showing a new slope all around one corner of the site that is depressed. There's a depressed cut all around the corner of the building by where those steps are. And in order to achieve that cut, it started at the edge of the sidewalk, not at the property line. So this is close to the large.
But that's another 15 feet in from the boundary, and those trees are on the other side of the boundary line.
The trees are on the other side of the boundary, but the grading starts right where the trees are, the excavation work. You're excavating off of your property.
For the sidewalk?
No, not for the sidewalk, but in order to get the stairway, in order to get that little stairway in there without any retaining wall work, but just by using side slopes. The side slopes extend all the way up to the sidewalk, which
that
appears
that stairway will go up, though, not down.
Right. Well, the contour lines on your plans indicate cut all the way up to the edge of the sidewalk, which is 10 feet off the property line. And that cut extends over to the building, which is 15 feet to the other side of the property line.
Can we defer to the landscape expert?
Have you gotten a copy of this late breaking letter? It kind of shows graphically which trees are in danger in that area.
Mark, let me just interject there. I don't mean to interrupt you, but Mark's absolutely right. Typically, in doing any grading plan, one's required to meet existing grade at the property line. And they're almost two-thirds of the way back along the school property. Every single one of those grades are well beyond, not only beyond the setback lines, but beyond the property line. And at the front of the building, they go all the way to the curb line, which is very unusual. So Mark's right on point. Whether or not the trees were disturbed, which they obviously will be, but even if they weren't, you would be required to get not only a construction easement, but some sort of other easement in order to do that.
Well, the easement isn't the problem, but destroying the trees would disturb me, so I, you know, we'll look into that. Mm-hmm. Do you have any suggestions?
What Tom was talking about earlier about looking at the spot grade of each tree in mm-hmm. sort of before and after condition would highlight something like that.
Okay.
Any other members?
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Emery.
Sorry to be repetitive. Last time we talked about having an explanation on the approach you're taking to the shared parking concept. Just talk us through that. But before we get to that, I think it would be an informative exercise for everyone. The ordinance has standards in terms of parking lot arrangements and minimum dimensions, and as you know, vehicles are getting larger all the time. They used to be getting smaller, now they're getting quite a bit larger. I think it would be interesting, rather than having the tail wag the dog, let the dog wag the tail, and without doing a full set of drawings to prove this, just simply have your architect go through the exercise or site engineer, whomever's doing the site planning, of following the town standards with the aisle requirements, the minimum space requirements, allow the circulation to work according to normal parking lot practice, see how many spaces you have, and back out of that number of spaces, how large the addition would be to the building and how that might affect the building program.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Go ahead, Tom.
Would you like to go through the parking?
I was going to address that. I had a question, Maureen.
I just wanted to let you know, Tom, that I met with Mr. Tinsman this morning, and we talked about almost exactly that same thing, that we thought the whole parking lot really needed a second look.
Okay.
The one thing I had, and we had talked very clearly about adhering exactly to the standards in the ordinance, the one thing I had suggested that I hope the board will be able to give the applicant some guidance on tonight is how far you're willing to go to apply the shared parking. Because I told him that what he really needed to leave the meeting tonight with was a number that the board was expecting him to have to accommodate the existing building. And if he looks at his parking lot again and he can't accommodate that number of parking places in designing the parking lot, then he's got to take a second look at the building size. But I think it would really help him if he had a good sense of, you know, whether the board is willing to look at shared parking, whether you're expecting to have the full number of spaces you would need if every single use in the building was fully occupied at one time, or whether you're willing to adjust that a little.
Okay. Mr. Chairman?
Yes, go ahead.
I, for one, don't know exactly what you mean, Maureen, by shared parking.
Go ahead and answer, please.
The idea is that for many uses, they have peak hours, and that if you can combine uses in one building where you can reasonably expect the high parking demand for one use to not be at the same time as the high parking demand for the other use, that you don't have to build a parking lot that accommodates the most amount of parking spaces you could ever possibly need. One of the classic examples is combining, say, retail or office with apartment or residential space. The idea being that most of the time you need residential parking overnight, that during the day people don't always have their cars there because they're out working, they're out doing errands, whereas office space, typically you need that office space during the day, but you don't really need it before 7 a.m. in the morning, you don't usually need it after 6 o'clock at night. So that those two uses tend to be a compatible shared use parking. So the space that's used overnight for the resident ends up getting used during the daytime for the office worker. The crux is to match up those uses so that they're fairly opposite in terms of when they need that space.
Mr. Tinsman, on page 2 of the plan submitted this evening, halfway down on the right, there's a parking requirement analysis. And I'd like you to correct me if I'm wrong in reading it the way I have, but for example, third item down, the coffee shop, showing peak times and non-peak times, you're assuming that there will be about 50 vehicles a day coming in to use the coffee shop facility?
Why don't you?
Mr. Nemes? On page 2 of your plan,
right
down in the middle. Right-hand side.
The requirement is under required spaces. If you took the square footages or the numbers of apartments or whatever it is that generates the parking space numbers, and you divided it by the required square footage or number of people, you get the required spaces, which is under that required spaces column, which is like 54 and a half spaces required if you took the square footages and the requirements for each of those spaces.
Agreed.
Okay. Then we went through and we made some assumptions with respect to the hours of operation of each of these various uses, and spread it out. I noted that there's maybe a 6 to 8 in the morning time block, and then an 8 to in the morning to 5 in the afternoon time block, and so on. And tried to put a percentage or a of when the peak times in each of these items were to come to some sort of an idea of what kind of parking generation would be would be a fairly good assumption.
So those numbers of 18.75 is a percentage of the business you expect between 6 and 8 a.m., or are those actual vehicle counts?
No, those are those. In fact, it's 18.75 is the requirement for 75 seats.
Okay.
Okay, and so if the 75 seats were full, it, according to the code, should be generating that number of parking spaces for a full coffee shop.
Again, in using this information that's proposed and compiling it all together with a little bit of common sense, you're looking at about 50 or 60 cars per day coming in to use the coffee shop facility, spread out through the day, most of them coming in during peak times. Would that be a good assumption on my part?
No, I'm not sure you can extrapolate cars per day from these numbers here. These numbers here are what generate the number of spaces.
Agreed.
Yep. And I would imagine that the coffee shop, even though we could get 18 spaces allotted to the coffee shop in an hour, I would imagine that from 6 to 8 in the morning, you may be getting 4 or 5 cars in each one of those spaces. So your actual number of cars might be quite a bit more than 18. I would imagine you're probably going to be up around, I don't know, let's say 3 spaces per hour per car. Maybe 30.
I'm just trying to get a picture as to how many vehicles are going to be in and out of that lot per day before I personally make a decision as to whether the parking lot is adequate. I have a restaurant and hotel background, and the average per person expenditure in a coffee shop is about $5, taking the person coming in for coffee, the person coming in for lunch, and the person buys a donut or a muffin with their coffee. And a business like this, to pay its fixed cost of operation and show a profit, they're going to have to generate between $800 and $1,000 a day. And if you divide that by 5 and figure there's about 3 people per car, that's an awful lot of vehicles.
Yeah.
And that's where my thinking is leading as to whether or not the parking lot is adequate.
And I would think that my way of looking at the adequacy of the parking lot with respect to the coffee shop should be that it should be able to handle the code required parking spaces for that coffee shop. And that is one space for every 4 seats plus 1 for every staff. And so we've got like 23 spaces assigned to that coffee shop. And sometimes they're going to be used several times an hour, other times in the middle of the afternoon. I would imagine they're going to be sitting empty for a while.
Well, I can agree with you. And many times this board has to vote yes on applications simply because it meets all the requirements of the code, but in our heart we know it may fail in real life, and
I
for one member don't want to do that.
That was the philosophy of generating that chart.
Okay.
Can I make one other point?
Yes, Mr. Tinsley.
On top of that is that one of the things that I believe the town center is trying to create is a pedestrian-friendly atmosphere for use, and our intention of creating so many sidewalks and the fact that we're in the town center is that we will get a lot of pedestrian traffic, people who are walking to the site not using the parking spaces. Specifically, the coffee shop should be very popular with the high school, and maybe even the maintenance garage up the street, or town employees or people in the shopping center that can't get coffee or a place to sit down. So we're hoping to make this a pedestrian friendly center that people can walk to and not need to use the parking. That's quite a bit of our intent. And I think given our proximity for location, that we're hoping that happens.
I had not taken that into consideration, and I do agree with some of your conclusions. One of the things I'd like to suggest, and just to have you work on it to see if it works, is limiting or just changing slightly some of the hours of operations of the other tenants. I'd be very curious as to what you would lose as a realtor if your office didn't open till 9:30, so that those spaces would be available during the morning hours to the coffee shop. I notice one of your proposed tenants would be a certified public accountant or some other type of administrative services. If they could operate during certain times of the day, that might free up some spaces for the gym or the coffee shop.
Mm-hmm.
Your administrative offices, for example, if they could close at 4:30 or 5, on a normal basis. I'm not saying you have to deny a client access on occasion, but if you could just use some common sense to open up some of those spaces for the peak times of the gym and health club and the coffee shop. and the sidewalks and the landscaping are going to be the two tools you'll have that will make it pedestrian-friendly.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery?
I guess I would have a bit of an issue with that. This approval will ride with the property. And I can't in any way imagine having a real estate office not open until on a, as a general policy to free up other spaces. I think what you're describing in terms of the number of cars in and out of this lot is more of a traffic study, which would tie in with a parking assessment as well in terms of the total daily trips and the peak hour trips. Ultimately, the number of parking spaces here, whether it's by ordinance or by what you're suggesting, Tom, is going to determine the success or lack of success of the businesses that are in there. If people can't get in, if there's not a parking space, if it's difficult to get in and out of the parking spaces, they'll go somewhere else. They may go down to the convenience store and buy a cup and not try to get in and out. So I don't think the issue of parking is so much arm wrestling with either the planning board or the town standards. So many times today, I just see that the issue, you can just take the town standards and put them aside for a minute. Many developers require more spaces than the town standards require because they're finding that they're putting in an office space, they're putting people into different types of furnishings rather than into fixed partitions, and they're just getting more people per square foot into their office buildings, and they don't have adequate parking, even with, in some cases, 4 per 1,000 or 5 per 1,000. So I see this as a just trying to come to some understanding of what you really need here, and not trying to use smoke and mirrors either on the planning board's part or your part, but coming to a realistic number. I can't imagine an office that would normally operate from 8 to 5 that people, I mean, I would hope that there would be people there at 7:30 and there would be people there as late as 6 o'clock. I think the way to deal with that is to assume that if you have a total parking requirement as you have in one column based on the requirement of the ordinance, that at off-peak hours for certain other uses that you might indicate that, for example, that there might be one or two people left at the office at 7:30 in the morning or 5 o'clock at night, rather than to assume that it's all or nothing with the use. I think the real challenge here, other than determining how many people you can fit into the health club, is the issue of residential uses. This is a suburban community with a lot of rural character, and it's very reasonable to assume that there would be two cars as the ordinance requires. That doesn't allow for any visitors parking. That's just two individuals in an apartment or many individuals with two cars. And those individuals are not going to be very happy tenants if at any time during the day or the weekend they can't find a parking space. And I would assume the only way to deal with that is to have reserved parking for the tenants during weekend hours or other hours. So I guess what I'd like to do is back up once again and have you present as quickly as possible. Just give us an overview of the case that you've made on this paper so it can get a public record. And I think it's much easier for us to understand if you read through it and discuss the assumptions that you've made in coming with this proposal.
Mm-hmm.
Any further questions from the board? Okay, go right ahead, Mr. Nemes.
We can do this briefly and continue on what I was talking about before about the philosophy of this thing. Maybe the best way to do this is by taking each unit, going across and giving each unit rather than jumping back and forth between them. So let's take the existing offices and the existing real estate businesses. There's a requirement for 6.7 spaces based on the square footage that existing. And we're saying that maybe of those 6.5 spaces, maybe one space will be there between 6 and 8 in the morning, assuming that somebody gets in early or something. From 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., all 6.7 spaces will be available for the real estate office. And from 5 to 10, we expect maybe two people out of that real estate office will be there from 5 to 10. But may or may not be true, but that. And then from 10 o'clock on to 6 o'clock in the morning, be nobody there for the real estate people, and maybe one person there on the weekend. With respect to the health club, there's a requirement for 13.5 spaces. We're saying that all 13.5 spaces would be used between 6 and 8 in the morning. between 8 and 5, 8 in the morning and 5 in the afternoon. Maybe 11 of those 18 spaces would be used, or 11 of those 13. Between 5 and 10, where it might pick up again with a complete full allotment of 13 and a half. And between 10 o'clock at night and 6 o'clock in the morning, there's no use there. And we've put in the full allotment of 13 and a half for weekend use, because I would maybe pick some time the weekend when everything was going on. The coffee shop, with a combination of the seats and the staff, we have a requirement for almost 23 spaces. We're saying that between 6 and 8 in the morning, all 23 of those spaces would be used. From 8 till 5, all 23 of those spaces would be used. From 5 to 10, maybe 8 would be used. It's going to be, and after 10 o'clock, none of them would be used. The second floor offices, there's another 800 square foot of office space on the second floor in there. That would be the same sort of a philosophy as a real estate office. There's a requirement for like 3.5 spaces. We'll put one space be occupied before 8 o'clock, from 6 to 8. But during the day, from 8 to 5, there'd be all of those 3.5 spaces would be used. One would be used from 5 to 10 at night. And one on the weekend, maybe one space allotted. And using those kind of breakdowns, the four housing units, we had eight cars would be used between 8 or 6 and 8 in the morning. Between 8 in the morning and 5 p.m., we thought maybe three of those cars could be used. And after 5 o'clock at night, all 8 spaces would again be residential. And so, and then adding all those spaces up, we found that we had a maximum of about 47 spaces at between 8 and 5 in the morning, or 8, between 6 in the morning and 5 at night, where this would be a maximum of about 46 spaces. And from 5 to 10 at night, maybe a maximum of like 35 spaces. And from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., we'd only be need 8 spaces. That's reasonable. Given if that kind of those kind of assumptions based on the relative weight of those parking requirements throughout the day are true, and we need about 47 spaces, last time we showed up with like 49, we took a couple spaces out for parking back and forth, so we've shown 47 spaces, which accommodates this kind of an analysis.
Thank you.
Is that reasonable?
Anything further from board members?
I'm not sure we addressed the issue that Maureen raised in terms of this chart.
Which was what? We didn't address something.
In your discussion with Maureen, you had asked for feedback from the board whether or not what the board felt about in terms of this interpretation of shared parking. I have no issue with shared parking. I think it's a great thing to do if you've got a church next to a residential development or retail, and before retail was open on Sunday, you could use the retail parking lot to go to, you know, for Easter Sunday or peak hour parking at the church. So I think it's just a matter of how the numbers are interpreted. I think in terms of your health club, I guess I'd really like to know. I'm having a lot of trouble reading this chart, and I don't have the ordinance in front of me. Is this calculated on a per square foot basis?
Yes.
How many people do you think would be, how many people will that health club accommodate at a reasonable capacity?
Well, these are all assumptions, and there's no way of knowing exactly how many people are going to be there at any one given time, but I can say that people aren't going to go there when it's crowded. I mean, they're going to try to avoid the peak times, so that there's probably, on average, I would say, probably going to be 6 to 8 people there at most of the peak times. Just based on my experience of using facilities.
It's not clear to me how people don't use. I'm not trying to be argumentative. I'm just trying to talk through the assumptions. There are certain people have certain times of day. If they're not working in town center, maybe that's who you're going after here. But people are at work, or they're having dinner, or they're going to, you know, whatever they're doing, there tends to be times a day where there are peaks, and not all people can avoid those peak hours.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't disagree with you if you can avoid the peak. Sometimes it's you can get the equipment more quickly or more attention, but there are certain instructors that perhaps are going to be there, and they're not going to be there during off-peak hours. But given the square footage you have allocated for that area, if you had people standing as they normally do in an exercise situation, I don't know if that's one per 15 square feet or something like that. If I think that's a reasonable calculation. If you were hosting a class, how many people could you?
Okay, well, I'd like to introduce Steve Anderson. He is a fitness expert, spent how many years doing this? He'll be operating the fitness center, so he can give you a...
And I want everyone to be very clear. I'm not trying to be argumentative. I only want the numbers to work so you don't end up in a situation where you don't have enough parking or you have too much. I just want to be very clear on what everybody's understanding to be the need and how the shared concept works.
Good evening. There's a formula that I just read, and it says, for this type of facility, 2 square feet per person the overall square footage need to allow for that room, for the flow, for that to be accommodating flow as well. 2 square feet.
Yeah. Yes, Nancy, go right ahead.
Steve,
mm-hmm.
How many are you going to have machines in there?
Yes, we will.
How many machines are you going to have? What kind of machines? I mean, mm-hmm. You have an idea about how many people you can accommodate in that
yes.
space.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And how many people do you think that you could accommodate for a class from, say, 8 to 9 in the morning?
Okay. Are you talking for a specific class in a group setting, perhaps?
Yeah.
Because we're
Isn't
thinking
that what
six,
you're planning?
6 to 8 people, yes.
6 to 8 people?
Within a classroom, yes.
All right.
Not in the fitness area itself, within a group class. We'll probably have a circuitry of perhaps 10 circuit stations, 10 pieces,
yep.
and then free weights as well. So it will be broken down into segments where there'll be a cardiovascular area with probably 6 to 8 machines, a strength training area, and a flexibility area.
Are you going to have exercises too?
Yes.
You're going to
yes.
have someone teaching a class?
In terms of group classes, yes, correct. Yeah. And we were basing our assumptions on groups of approximately 6 to 8, if the demand is there. So it's open to a lot of flexibility.
So with all that being said, how many people do you, and again, this gets back to the business plan, how many people do you need to have in your health club during peak periods, typical peak periods during the morning to make it worthwhile you're getting up and going to?
In terms of accommodating that,
yes.
that amount of people. Yeah, I would say probably 20 or so. Now, if it's on separate floors, that's taking into account people who are changing in the locker room, coming into the reception area, going upstairs to working out as well. So there'll be an ever flow. Mm-hmm.
And how many, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
And how many staff are you going to have?
We were thinking probably 4 to 5, or perhaps 4 people to start with, and seeing what the demand is to make sure that people are.
So that's hungry. 4 parking spaces taken up.
At the same time? No, probably a receptionist, a manager, and then a staff person. So 3 with a rotating person as well at any one time.
So we've heard somewhere in the neighborhood of 23 to 24 people could be there.
At a peak time, approximately, yeah.
But
I would say
time,
worst case
time
scenario.
Isn't 5 minutes out of a class. Peak time would tend to be the whatever time frame is here. It's mm-hmm. going to be more than an hour time frame, is it not?
Typically. Now, in this residential setting, in an urban setting in town, peak times would be before work. So it depends upon if people were working out and responding to work. So I'm not really sure what peak times. Typical peak times could be from 7 a.m. to 8:30. Then again at lunchtime. Then again just after work, 5:30 to 6:30 or something. Here is probably going to be a little bit different scenario, I would imagine.
And excuse me for...
Right ahead, Tom.
I guess my question would be then, and again, this is whatever you guys propose, is again to satisfy yourself with a question, let alone us, that if, if you as a tenant might need as many as 24, my sense is that if you have 20 people in the building, knowing how people work in this community and how flexible they have to be with independent transportation, it's very likely most of those people may come with their own vehicles, unless they're living in the building.
Unless they come together in groups and people carpool and come in to work out for a specific...
And if you have a history of that, that you have people who work at the same company or however they may happen to carpool, I think that's all part of the formula. I don't know if it's worst case or reasonable case, but you could have, from what you've described, somewhere between 20 and 23, 24 spaces that you may be required at a time when you're only allowing, in the formula, 13.6 spaces at peak period. So whether it's 13.6 or 24 materially doesn't mean a lot to me, but I think it means, it should mean a lot to you, and then just come back to the board with that final calculation.
Right.
Go ahead, Nancy.
And one more question, and I promise this
sure.
is my last. Are you going to have showers?
Yes, we are. We're planning on that.
So people are also going to stay and take a shower, probably.
They will have that option. I'm thinking that currently I own a personal training facility in town, and so I work by hourly appointments as well. Showers are not as much an option, but we did want to make that available for them. So I would anticipate that the majority of people will come ready to work out and probably leave that way if they're going back to their homes and the comfort of their own shower
facility. Well, what if they're going back to work, though?
Then they do have the shower available.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Go right ahead.
Motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Tom Tinsman for site plan review of the Ariben Center retail / office / apartment project located adjacent to the existing building located at 349 Ocean House Road be tabled to the regular March 16th, 1999 planning board meeting.
I second that.
Any further discussion? Mr. Emery?
I want to be very clear. I want to be very careful and understand whether the applicant feels as though they got the information from the board or the response or direction from the board that Maureen had asked about earlier.
Mr. Tinsman, Mr. Nemes, do you have any questions of the board?
Yeah, I think we have a very clear idea, and we'll be meeting with Maureen to clear up anything that we don't understand.
Thank you. Mr. Wilcox.
One issue with the plan that we hadn't touched on that you could perhaps take a look at is the width of the entry drive is the same as the 24-foot width as though it were a parking aisle, but it in fact is not a parking aisle. It doesn't have cars backing out in the direction onto it. If that gives you any leeway in narrowing it from 24 feet to achieve a little more buffer to the lot line, I think that would be something that would be good for you to take a look at. I would not agree with the assertion in the materials submitted that the existing driveway location is grandfathered because you're simultaneously not using the same amount of parking in the grandfathered parking lot that's there now. So you may have an existing driveway location that serves a 20-car parking lot, but when you increase that to a 50-car parking lot, I would not necessarily assume that that location is grandfathered, and you may need, in fact, to ask the board for a waiver for that.
You brought up a point earlier about the parking lot going out to the boundaries. I was talking specifically about this area in here where we're trying to save trees.
Oh, right, yeah.
Not on the perimeter, but on the interior of the parking.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that was one thing I didn't clarify.
Any further comments before we take a vote? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Any opposed? Thank you. It carries unanimously. Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. Next item on the agenda, Sprague Master Subdivision Plan.
Mr. Chairman, I'll recuse myself.
Mr. Emery, thank you. Mr. Green, whenever you're ready.
Mr. Carter, members of the board, my name is John Green. I'm the property manager of the Sprague Corporation. With me tonight, Seth Sprague from the Sprague Corporation, and Amy Bell Siegel from Terry DeWan's office. Terry could not be here tonight, so we will commence without him. We provided a packet to the board, and I'm going to quickly give a brief overview of the items in your packet so that we can understand where we have come since last meeting. We have a revised phase one and a bank letter of credit, a revised phasing plan, and a summary of phasing improvements, a revised fire protection plan, a modification to lot five, and a Maine Department of Environmental Protection stormwater permit approval as all part of your packet. Regarding phase one, I will start with that. After consideration and in order to facilitate this process that we've been through, we have added Monastery Road and its improvements to what we are now calling phase one. Phase one will now include all of Japanese Pond Road and Monastery Road, those portions of the emergency loop road. As discussed at prior meetings, we do not wish to alter the Ram Island Farm Road until such time its improvement is triggered by development, as we have stated in the past. I will note that several trees have been removed for emergency vehicle clearance on Ram Island Farm Road since your site visit with the ladder truck, so we have made some improvements to portions of that road. As you know, phase one will be completed within the three-year time frame outlined in the subdivision ordinance. Regarding the phasing plan itself, in light of questions that were raised by the board at the last meeting, we have in the interim met with Maureen O'Meara and Steve Harding, the town engineer, to discuss the phasing issue. The results of that meeting are manifest in the new Sheet 7 phasing plan that was included in your packet, which is color-coded here, as well as revisions to Sheet 4, the fire protection plan, that was also included in your packet. A total of 20 separate phases are shown. These phases are listed numerically. Other than phase one, which will be completed within the three-year time frame, the other phases may occur in any order, depending on when a triggering event occurs. Very simply, in order to complete a phase, in the left-hand column here on the phasing schedule, the required phase prior to is listed on the right-hand side. So in other words, if we chose a phase such as phase nine, and you work across, phase one, two, and eight would be required to be completed prior to phase nine being done. So we tried to come up with a clear, succinct way of delineating the phase plan, and we did so with Maureen and Steve's help. While we're on the topic of phasing, I would like to mention several points Maureen mentioned in her memo dated February 16th that relate to the phasing plan. One, Maureen noted that the board may wish to require improvements to the Ram Island Farm Road as part of phase one. As we have represented many times, we do not intend to improve Ram Island Farm Road until its use is required by a triggering event. And we can discuss some of these items a little later on here. Maureen noted that phase seven should be added to the list and completed in order for work to begin on phase nine. And if you look at the phasing plan, it's very simple to see the different phases. You can probably refer to these phases as I speak to them on your set of plans. We do not wish to improve the Fieldways Road and Sakoki Trail in order to construct the phase seven. In other words, in order to complete phase nine over here, we do not want to complete Sakoki Trail in phase seven, nor the portion of Fieldways Lane there. The reason for that is that the portion of Fieldways Lane that we're referring to is actually part of the secondary emergency loop. Coot Lane will be improved to 12 feet wide. We feel that Trelawney Trail will be 16 feet wide. There is no need to be improving Fieldways Lane other than it exists now for a secondary emergency access purpose. Item three, Maureen noted that phase 7 should be complete before phase 10 can be constructed. Although we don't want to construct Sakoke Trail, if phase 10, the last section of Fieldways Lane, was done, I believe we would be happy to create a new phase so that this remaining portion of Fieldways Road, should it be required, would need to have the first portion of Fieldways Lane done. So I think what we would do there is add a new phase to allow that to happen. It was an oversight that Maureen caught, and it is appropriate to assume that the first portion should be done prior to the last portion being put in. So we'd be happy to remedy that problem. Maureen also noted that a temporary turnaround is needed for phase 8. That is the Trelawney Trail, the first portion, and we agree with that. And in fact, we have already made some changes to our plans to accommodate a temporary turnaround. Item five, inconsistencies in the plan. Maureen noted that given the size of the project, some inconsistencies were inevitable between the overview sheets and the detailed construction sheets, and we agree with that comment. We have provided the overview sheets as a method of clarifying a large volume of information that's included in the plans. We did not intend to rely on these sheets for construction purposes. We would be happy to provide a note that states all construction to be performed per the applicable plan and profile sheets, so that there's no confusion that the plan and profile sheets are what would be required for construction purposes. We are now reviewing a checked set of plans. In fact, we have the final set of plans produced that are being reviewed by ourselves as well as the town engineer for those inconsistencies. So we're hoping to catch most of them, but we will provide the note stating such. Regarding the fire protection plan, the new plan that we have here, also included in your packet, it is separate and distinct from the phasing plan now. The chart in the lower left-hand corner now has the year of improvement added to the fire pond list. You can see the upgrade year has been added as we had discussed at the prior meeting. This depicts whether we also have on the lower right corner an emergency access and fire protection summary that was added to our fire protection plan that will allow someone to look at a lot, whether existing or a new lot, and determine by reading over what kind of fire protection will be required, i.e. whether or not the lot will be required to have a pond improvement, the lot to be sprinkled, or the lot to be on a municipal hydrant. So that has been added to this plan to make it a little easier to read. A non-detail sheet 5 showing a typical hydrant detail as provided by the fire chief states the dry hydrant and pond construction shall be approved by the town of Cape Elizabeth fire chief. So we wanted to make sure that on the detail sheet 5 we did put a note that says these pond improvements will be under the purview of the fire chief. And that in fact is stated in the set of plans that you already have. We will add a note to this fire protection plan, it is not on there now, for comments that access roads will be part and parcel of the hydrant improvement process as we have represented. Nowhere in the plans did we actually specifically state that access roads would be part of this dry hydrant improvement process, and we will add the note that those access roads will in fact be improved at such time a hydrant is improved. That note will be added. The modification to lot 5 on sheet 5-3 that was included in your packet, and that's this modification to the family center area. We have reviewed that modification to lot 5 with staff, and the revisions were deemed acceptable. We can address any questions following my comments here. The Maine Department of Environmental Protection stormwater permit We received our final approval from Maine DEP, and a signed copy was enclosed in your packet. Steve Harding, the town engineer, also provided a letter in your packet. Steve's only substantive comment was regarding the performance guarantee. Steve noted that additional information was required on a unit cost basis for several items. Our engineer, Les Berry of BH2M Engineers, will provide Steve with the additional information. And so we will let staff work that out with our engineer. Les has, again, provided Steve with a final revised set of plans for his review. And all of Steve's comments, Steve Harding's comments, as well as the board here to this date, are included in this final set of plans. So everything we've discussed to this date is included in a final set of plans that is now being reviewed. So we have a final set of plans done per all the comments that you have given us. Maureen has kindly drafted a motion of approval as part of her memo to you. There are three or four points in this approval motion that we do not quite agree with. I believe with a few edits, it may be possible for us to come to some sort of agreement and put this project to rest tonight. I would be happy to outline these points in the approval motion at the appropriate time. And please let us know how you'd like to proceed from this point, and we'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Mr. Green, if I may, why don't you continue for those items you wish to question on the proposed motion for approval.
I may ask Seth Sprague to step up in a minute, but I will start here. We have the findings of fact as the beginning portion of that motion. Finding of fact number two, we do not plan on improving the full emergency access loop, but a portion of it. On item three of the findings of fact, it's a little confusing as to the phase 9 and 10 issue. We fully intend to include a new phase, I'm not sure the number, but should phase 10, the final portion of Fieldways Lane, be needed, we will provide a phase that will include that beginning portion that was missing. What we do not intend to do is improve Fieldways Lane to its full 16-foot width unless the Sakokie Trail is needed. In other words, for Trelawney Trail, we feel that as a secondary means of access, the Fieldways Lane, the beginning portion of that driveway, as well as the Coote Lane connector are adequate at this point, and there would be no need to be upgrading.
Mr. Green, are the comments you just made included in your phasing plan?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
The other ones aren't, the ones I stated prior to. Mm-hmm. We will have to add one additional phase. Item four in the findings of fact, it says phase 8 is currently designed as a dead-end road with no turnaround. It is true there is no turnaround, but it is not a dead-end road. Essentially, with the Coote Lane connector, we have an emergency loop road with what would then be a driveway to one lot coming off of it. So I just want to make it clear that it, in fact, is not a dead-end. We've provided Coote Lane to mitigate the dead-end road issue. That's all the items I had for the findings of fact. On the items based on the plans and materials submitted, be it ordered that, there are, I believe, seven items or so. We have comments on a couple of those items as well. Number one is, in fact, that Ram Island Farm be added to phase one. Again, we've represented in the past, and we feel it is not necessary until such time down the road it is triggered. So therefore, we feel we do not agree with item number one. We'd like to leave our phasing plan intact as we have represented. Item two, that the phasing plan be amended to require that phase 7 must be constructed in order to construct phase 9 and 10. Again, that comes back to the issue of us adding an additional phase just to accommodate that last section of Fieldways Road. And that, again, would be phase 10 would require the first portion of Fieldways Road. We would have to amend our phasing plan again to include a new number, but we'd be happy to work that out with staff. That we then can work down to items 5 and 6. I have some concern that all improvements to the property, our property, would require a performance guarantee. In the past, we have done a lot of work down there and at our own risk, to make sure it meets town standards. And we just have a slight concern with item five that, in fact, any bit of work we do is going to require a performance guarantee. I'm not sure. I think I can let Seth address that issue briefly. And I will also let Seth step up here and address item six, where we have a bit of a language problem. I think it's something we can easily work through. There's a few key words that we absolutely cannot agree to because we would then be out of compliance with the ordinance instantly, or in fact with our own internal setup. So I'll let Seth address that issue. So if Seth would like to come up and address item five and six.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Sprague.
I think we're about to the end here, I hope. And the important issues for me on this last list, the order for approval, aside from the attempt to add Ram Island Farm Road to the phasing plan, which we really don't want to have to do, is number six, which is the condition of approval that we talked about some last month, and I had the opportunity to argue why we felt that the condition of approval that we propose and it's in our plan is the best one. And I would also add that this option that's detailed in item six here, we're not going to be able to live with because it has language in here down toward the bottom that prohibits us from leasing or otherwise transferring property. And this whole condition of approval thing relates to sometime in the future when Sprague Corporation is liquidated. This is what we're talking about. And we're all working very hard to make sure that doesn't happen. But this condition of approval is to plan for what would happen at that point. And I would argue once again that in the interest of good planning out in the future, if that should happen, that the condition of approval that we propose be the one that be adopted in the plan. And the reason for that is simple, good planning and creating a situation in the future or avoiding a situation that could be very chaotic in the future. Because we're talking about when the Sprague Corporation, which owns the whole track now, is liquidated and the property will be passed to family members. So in theory, we're creating 62 lots here. In theory, you could have at that liquidation 62 different lot owners. And I think what you want to avoid is a situation where at that point one single lot owner who comes to the planning board for a change will affect a lot owner that's a long way away that has no interest in the changes that are being provided. So what we've tried to do is mitigate that by having the changes that the planning board would require in that case be applied to the large lots, the 10 original lots in the subdivision. And that will create a much more orderly way to deal with changes to the plan after the Sprague Corporation doesn't exist anymore. So to me, that's the big hurdle still on the table to address, and be interested to know where the board stands on that issue.
Thank you, Mr. Sprague. Comments from the board? Questions? Mr. McNichols.
Mr. Sprague, there was a suit pending in federal court. What's happened to that? Is that still there?
It is continuing. The major portions of it were thrown out through a summary judgment, and that decision works in favor of the corporation and the continuation of the corporation.
So what is left does not imperil the corporation. Is that a fair statement?
No, that's a fair statement.
Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to make a few brief comments. Once a project is approved by the planning board, it becomes my responsibility as the town manager to see it forward. That does involve the looking at performance bonds and ensuring that the work is completed in accordance with the approved plans. Without a performance bond in place for all the required improvements on the plan, that is virtually impossible to do. And, you know, while the Sprague Corporation may want to do something at one time or something at another, it just becomes a totally unworkable situation if they're doing it on their own without knowledge and without the performance guarantees in place. Also, did want to comment two other points. On the performance guarantee itself that was submitted by Main Bank and Trust, there's a provision in the ordinance that requires that the form of the letter of credit be approved by both the town manager and by the town attorney. I have not approved that form of the letter of credit. I do have several concerns with it. If you are inclined to approve this plan this evening, I would urge you to have as a condition that ultimately the performance guarantee would need to be approved in writing by the town manager and by the town attorney prior to the Mylar being released. That is in there as well. The final issue is, you know, I was very concerned with the suggestion just made by Mr. Sprague in terms of opening up the issue again of sale of the lots. And, you know, this is a very, very major issue. We've had several meetings on it. And I would urge the board to be extremely careful with approving a final enacted plan with language that all the parties don't 100% agree to. And if the Sprague Corporation has objections to the language that Ms. O'Meara has drafted, that the town attorney has seen, and the town attorney has not seen any revised language that may be submitted, I would really urge the board to table this and give the opportunity for the corporation to meet with the town attorney to work out language that is unequivocally clear, because the suggestion that that provision might be rewritten this evening in order to gain an approval is very worrisome to me, and I think in the best interests of both the town and the Sprague Corporation be important to really have that tied down. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Mr. McNichols?
Question for Maureen. Any motion to table must be by consent, is that correct?
Yes. Further, if there's a motion that the board would like that I haven't drafted tonight, you can always take a 5-minute recess and I can draft something else up for you.
Mr. Sprague, until such time as the language in number 6 is clarified to the agreement of all parties concerned, would you have any objection to tabling this matter?
Well, I'd like to make a further effort to try to narrow down what the problem is. If I could get an indication whether or not you have a problem with the large lot concept, that makes a difference to whether or not we can quickly come to an agreement.
I personally do not, but my fear is, and it is a fear, is that we only have one member of the board who's an attorney, and I'm not going to subject him to speak for all of us. But not being an attorney, I'm not going to attempt to rewrite a motion tonight with something this substantial in it without having it approved by the town attorney.
That's
unfortunate. That's
unfortunate
how I feel.
Because this has been the language that we've had before the planning board since October. But if you'd like to table that'd be fine.
Thank you, Mr. Sprague.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Wilcox.
The the aspect of this that seems to be what needs to be dealt with, at least in my perspective, and maybe other members of the board could express their feelings about it, is that what we're dealing with is, because the phasing plan is nonlinear, at some point down the road, if a major change is made in the entities holding the land, it seems sort of like the sort of concept of through circulation and loop road could be defeated completely, depending upon when some type of change happened within the scheme of this sort of nonlinear development. Because then if there is only if current work at that point in time is only governed on one of the major lots, they depend on each other in order to get that loop road through.
We tried to address that in our language for the condition of approval, in that those emergency loop roads do tie across numbers of lots, so you need to assure yourself that is taken care of.
Am I just being thrown by the fact that Breakwater Farm Road is 17 and 18 and sort of seems to be at the end, but may not in fact really be at the end, and it's just numbered that way? In terms of developing that end of the property as a loop road also?
Well, I'm not quite understanding the question. If you could just restate it one more time. The numbering of the phases is unimportant, actually. Other than phase one, phase 18 could happen the next day. So the actual numbering is just a sequential numbering.
And that would trigger?
Right. Anything occurring in that green area would trigger the loop road over there.
And the green area is divided between the major existing subdivision lots of 8, 9, and 10. So, in essence, anything that happens on 8, 9, or 10 triggers that loop road?
That's correct. Any new lot would trigger that loop road. The first portion, the reason why we chose phase one here is because it's common between this loop road as well as this road. Right. So we are just referring to the Little Pond Lane Breakwater Farm Road loop. So anything occurring in the green, lot 9-1, 9-2, 10-3, 10-4, 10-1, or 10-2, any permit that would get pulled for that would trigger that improvement. Mm-hmm.
But not if there were a change in ownership structure.
Oh, change in ownership, yes.
Prior to that point in time, on 9 would be developed without the loop road going through 8 and 10.
Right. What we have said is in our condition of approval, that should lot 10 want to change something on the plan, it has been sold to the public, for example, that the impact, open space, affordable housing, anything the board requires would be applied to the lot where the development occurs. Mm-hmm. That's what we're saying. The loop road would be there regardless. In fact, in our conditions, should the loop road be needed to be upgraded to the town standard 24 feet, for example, that is allowed in our language as well.
So would it be correct in saying that the phasing requirements would still take precedence, even in the event of this?
Yeah, the phasing plan would still work.
The phasing plan would still work, even if there were no longer control of beyond the boundaries of the
Right, all we're saying is that the planning board purview would be restricted to this area with the exception of the emergency loop road. In other words, this person living over here, if they were then required to have affordable housing over here, it would cause quite a ruckus on lot one if it was lot 10 developing. And that's what we were trying to avoid.
Not unreasonable to attempt
Mr.
to put
Wilcox?
In place.
Yes. I believe Mr. McNichols has a point that might clarify things.
I've always been in favor of the phasing concept. I think it's really brilliant, and it does the least damage as these various lots are brought online. I think, though, that it fails if the corporation fails. I think that probably the easiest way around this situation is in the event of the failure of the corporation and the individual sale to non-family members, that that would immediately trigger all parts of the phasing operation complete. You don't see it happening.
But the problem with that is if we haven't, you know, we've built five houses, you allow for 62, you don't want to require building roads and constructing things that aren't necessary.
But see, again, you're going around the original intent, which was the phasing coming gradually online for family members, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Well, let's assume the corporation ceases to exist and you're selling these lots publicly.
Mm-hmm.
Then I think probably the phasing should come in
and bang. Well, in fact, this condition of approval states that if the corporation sells the property, then the whole game is up and you can create a new phasing plan. Get total review of the subdivision at that time. What we were talking about is in the instances when there are small parts that might be sold.
To non-members?
To non-members.
Why? You're not thinking of that.
No.
Then why fight about it?
Because we were asked to review the situation, and we think if you look out into the future and you do the what ifs, that our proposal will be the one that will manage the situation the best. Because if you could have a situation where you have 62 lots owned individually by family members, and then somebody decides that they want to sell one lot way over here, their decision to do that is no longer within the corporation, it's their individual decision, and it would perhaps have important ramifications on a lot owner a long way away who'd then be subject to whatever things that the planning board wanted to put on them at that time, even though they were in fact living within the plans that you're going to approve tonight.
As they often say, the devil's in the details. I've got some
Mr. Sprague. Roughly how many years has the Sprague Corporation owned the bulk of this land?
80 years.
And how much land has been sold off the original parcel to non-family members?
Very little, if any, that I'm aware of.
I think we're discussing a problem that's just not there.
But it's you're giving us an approval based on that continuing. And it's reasonable.
And we also granted numerous waivers based on that.
Right.
It was a win-win situation.
And that's great. And so, but that makes it incumbent on us to come up with what happens if.
If you don't want this provision in the plan, then you should submit a request to be reviewed as a regular subdivision.
As any lawyer would tell you, there's a simple way around it. Anytime you sell a lot to someone, you can always adopt them into the family. It's very easy.
Just have them marry somebody.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Nancy.
Question. How, on a scale of 1 to 10, how likely is it that the Sprague Corporation is going to break up?
It's unlikely, very unlikely. On 1 to 10, which way do you want me to go?
Well, from 1 to 100.
It's very near zero.
All right. And why are you so concerned about if this individual decides to sell a lot? I mean, can he? Can that person sell a lot?
Only
aren't
after,
they leasing them?
Only if the corporation were liquidated.
Yeah. And how likely is that?
It's not very likely. But you're asking us to put it on our plan, and it's poor planning. Now, to do it that way. If it's really going to cause you a problem and you're really unwilling to do it, that's what I'm trying to find out. And all it really boils down to is carving up the review of this plan at some future date that's highly unlikely into 10 different parcels rather than into one very large one.
Mr. Sprague, I'm of the personal opinion that number 6 under the conditions actually protects and enforces the Sprague Corporation. It would be one thing that would help prevent it from being broken up. Which
well, it does, but ours does it better.
Perhaps there's room for compromise with the Sprague Corporation's attorney and the town's attorney to rewrite it.
I enjoy working with attorneys as much as the next person is, but I'd rather work it out with you. if you're uncomfortable dealing with the major lot problem, we can go back to the town's language, we could accept that if we were to remove And the language that's in the motion is not the entire language that the town attorney had presented. And I have drafted up the entire original language that the problem that we have with the town's version are the words in number 2 in the motion that say that therefore if any of the subdivision including land or buildings within the subdivision is sold and then it says leased or otherwise transferred to anyone other than family members, if we could remove those four words, leased or otherwise transferred, from the condition of approval that the town attorney had drafted, and that's what I've done in the paperwork that I just given you, we could move on. And the reason that I'm suggesting that is because we currently lease property to non-family members. We've always lease property to non-family members. We don't do it a lot, but it's part of what we do, and we cannot agree to a condition of approval that we'll be in violation of immediately. The important thing was that we zero in on the fact that what would happen in the event of a sale to a non-family member. So,
go right ahead, Mr. McNichols.
We might possibly be able to settle on, we don't want to disturb any of the long-term leases that the family now has with non-family members. That's not the intent here. But I think what we're getting to is we would want some limitation on leases of these lots that are going to be developed under this plan. You don't have any plans there, I assume.
No.
Family members on, no. As I understood the whole concept, these lots were to be developed as needed for family members.
We could add language that said sold or leased for more than a year. That would preclude any, idea that it was being done for development purposes, but we have, seasonal rentals and.
Well,
Mr. Sprague, once again, I am a painting contractor. You're asking me to take legal language, make some modest changes to it, and then vote on it this evening. Because I am a painting contractor, I can't do that. I'm not an attorney. And I would be very uncomfortable if I were even forced into doing it by a majority of the board. And therefore, I think we have no choice but to table this. And I reluctantly table it because I would have loved to have voted yes on this whole matter 4 months ago.
I have to concur with the chairman. It seems to me that we need, and I'd like to give you some help in this area. First off, I don't see any other impediments to my voting in favor of the entire project. I think really we're wrestling with some very distant shadows, that is the dissolution of the corporation, the potential sale to others. But you've got to understand that we have waived a number of conditions that would be normal in any development. And I think that the town manager, quite rightly, is afraid of this falling into some sort of commercial development and being one up on the town. I think it's remote. I don't think it's it's likely to happen, but I think we've got to go back to the drawing board on that one issue, and I think we can then get it done.
Well, if you'd like to table it, it's all right with us.
With reluctance. If there isn't any further discussion, can I call for a motion, please? Mr. Parkhurst?
Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Sprague Corporation for final subdivision review, a resource protection permit, and four private accessway permits for a 62-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road be tabled to the regular March 16, 1999 meeting of the Planning Board with the consent of the applicant.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. McNichols. Any discussion? All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. Are there any opposed? There are not. Thank you very much.
Mr. Carter, one last question.
Right ahead, Mr. Green.
Regarding all the issues discussed tonight, were there any other impediments in anything discussed, i.e. phasing, fire protection, anything that the board would like us to do for next meeting other than this condition of approval?
Do any members of the town planner have a comment? Mr. Parker?
Didn't you say you needed to create one more phase?
Yes, I think we can work with town staff to provide that phase to accommodate that concern.
The other thing that seems to be, though, obviously the form of the letter of credit, the town manager is not comfortable with the one presented.
We will
language in the conditions of approval. Those seem to be the issues that I see.
We can address that with the town manager as well.
Thank you, Mr. Green.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Patrick Costin. I'm an architect with Harriman Associates. I'm here on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth and the addition renovations to the high school pool. I guess the only comments I will address to the board tonight have to do with a letter received from town planner regarding number of issues that remain to be addressed. Specifically, there's a request for an additional tree to be planted on an island in the upper parking lot. This location, we had omitted the tree at that location because there was a light fixture, and a request has been added to include the tree with the light fixture, and we're prepared to do so. There was a comment by the board on the foot candle readings that were at the entry to the new addition being too low. For the record, the reason was that we have not included the entryway lighting, which is going to be part of the building design. And so we will make sure that the lighting does meet the requirement of half a foot candle minimum illumination. And then we received a number of comments from the town engineer that relate to our drawings, minor things in our estimation, and we'd be happy to accommodate all of those comments and make corrections to our drawings. And beyond that, I'd be happy to answer any further questions the board might have with regard to this application.
Thank you. Maureen, any comments? Board members, questions or comments? Mr. Emery.
Did I get the island correct? It's the one that's sticking out. It's not one of the end islands. It's that one right there.
It was my understanding it is the intermediate island. That's correct.
Is that correct?
Yes.
I guess we understand that this project is on a very tight budget. There appear to be adequate trees there. They're spaced about 36 feet apart, and to stick one in the middle under the light, unless the other ones get spread out or something, doesn't really excite me too much. It just, we've got two in this just seems to be plenty of landscaping there. I mean, it may not meet the specific requirement in the ordinance. My sense in the ordinance is it's the islands at the end that is really being spoken to.
Mr. Parkhurst, on the same issue?
Reading this, I don't understand why you would want to put a tree and a light pole adjacent to each other. I just don't understand that.
Sir?
Reference in the correspondence that we had is to the parking lot behind the town hall, in which islands have included light poles and trees, and that the ordinance is written in a way that suggests that that is the arrangement the town center district expects to see. From an engineering standpoint, I'm an architect. From an engineering standpoint, there were some questions raised in my office as to why we would put a tree under the light, but I'm not in a position to make that judgment. I guess that was the request of the town planning office, and we are happy to accommodate it.
Well, can I ask the question of Maureen then?
Sure.
Why not just hang the light on the tree?
The town center guidelines, the design standards were written by the planning board, and it was your intent several years ago that you wanted to break up long expanses of parking, and so you specifically wrote a standard that said you could not have more than 10 parking spaces in a row without having an island that you said was landscaped that would break up the parking. And this applicant has chosen to place that particular island right there. The standard specifically calls for what we call the canopy tree. There's nothing that says you have to put a light and a tree next to each other, but the standard does say that you have to have a tree in that parking lot landscaped aisle. The applicant has chosen to place their light there as well. I'm suggesting they don't have to find another place for the light, that the light and the tree could coexist.
Okay. I think you have some leeway now, though.
Thank you.
May I ask the question?
Mr. Emery.
Does the plan as it's presently designed have adequate landscaping in terms of numbers?
There's nothing in our requirements that talk about specific numbers. We do talk about widths of buffers and density of buffers between compatible and non-compatible uses. The landscaping here is completely within the same lot, so we haven't even dealt with issues about landscaping along a buffer area. But that is the requirement, and I believe that's one of the reasons that the applicant was reticent about moving into the lower lot, is because they knew they were going to have to start looking at meeting that town center district standard.
Mr. Emery.
I have one other question. The engineer notes that there's a area near the entrance that has 0-foot candles.
Yes.
Is that something that can be reasonably remedied?
Yes. The lighting analysis that was submitted was for the site lighting fixtures only and did not include the lighting that will be at the entry to the building. And consequently, that was the reason why there were 0-foot candles reading there. There will be entrance lighting as part of the building that will illuminate that area.
Has there been any discussion among the building committee members regarding the column that's located at the corner? When the entrance of the building was redesigned, there's a column right at the corner, mm-hmm. Which is right on axis with the door. And mm-hmm. I think the major direction toward the door is actually, I assume it's on the diagonal. There obviously will be people coming from more on the orthogonal, so to speak. But has that been raised as an issue? We did that on a building, and the owner ended up cutting the column down, so to speak. I mean, it was a design column. It wasn't a structural column, but they elected to remove it.
In this case, it is a structural column, and the answer to your question is no, there was not. There is a significant little plaza sort of outside the entryway, which we believe provides adequate maneuvering room.
And that is a double set of doors, is it not? So the column could help direct people in the...
That's correct.
Couldn't get rid of the retaining wall.
We did our best.
Okay. No further questions.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Further discussion? Mr. Emery.
May I make a motion?
You certainly may.
Findings of facts. One, the town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting site plan review of the expansion of the community pool located at the rear of the high school. Two, the application was deemed complete in December 1998 and a public hearing was held on January 19th, 1999. Three, the town center district includes parking lot requirements that mandate at least one landscaped island planted with a tree for every 10 parking spaces in a row. Four, the site plan regulations require that adequate exterior lighting must be provided for the safe use of the development during nighttime hours. Five, the town engineer has recommended revisions to the plan which eliminate inconsistencies and improve the final design. Six, the application substantially complies with section 19-9 site plan regulations and section 19-6-4 town center district. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for an expansion of the community pool located at the rear of the high school be approved subject to the following conditions. Condition one, that a road tree be planted in the island on the southeast side of the upper parking lot. Two, that the lighting be added to the entry area that provides a minimum illumination of 0.5 foot candles. Three, that the plans be revised per the engineer's comments in the letter dated February 5th, 1999, and four, that there be no alteration to the site nor issuance of a building permit until the plans have been revised in accordance with the above conditions as determined by the town planner.
Second.
We have a motion that's been made and seconded. Is there further discussion by board members? Call for a vote. All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Any opposed? It is unanimous. Thank you
very much.
Is the pool closed now?
Excuse me.
When is the pool going to close?
In early April, until November of this year.
Well, that was the other condition, that this would be done without closing the pool.
And we get free membership. St. Bartholomew's Church.
Thank you.
I can go another hour. I can't feel my left leg anymore, but I'm all right. If you could begin, sir, by identifying yourself and give a quick overview of the project, please.
Mr. Chairman and board members, good evening. My name is John Deckrow. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth and a member of St. Bartholomew Parish. I'm also chair of the St. Bartholomew Facility Planning Committee. Tonight I'm joined with Father Michael Henschel, pastor of St. Bartholomew Parish, Dennis Lemieux, and Andy D. Hayes from Harriman Associates, the project architects. We are here tonight to request approval of the site plan for the renovation and addition at St. Bartholomew's Church as detailed in the Planning Board submission dated January 29, 1999. Based on correspondence subsequent to the submission, we are pleased to note that the town engineer and Quest Associates are of the opinion that the submission is complete. This correspondence does include discussion points, which we are prepared to discuss. First, I would like to give a brief overview of the project. Since 1971, the parishioners of St. Bartholomew's Church have held their liturgy, education programs, and social activities in a 16,000 square foot open and flexible multi-purpose facility. After careful review, the Planning Committee has recommended and the parishioners have accepted the program to divide the existing space to provide a permanent dedicated worship space with pews rather than chairs and space for education programs and administration offices. To meet the social needs, it is proposed that a new 6,100-foot square foot fellowship hall be added. It should be noted that the renovation and addition are designed to meet the current census of the parish, as it is anticipated that the parish nor the town will grow significantly. At this time, I am pleased to introduce Dennis Lemieux from Harriman to address any technical questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, John. What I would like to do prior to answering any specific questions you may have, we have received a letter from the town planner basically making reference that the project has submitted is complete, but she had one question in terms of lighting that I would like to address this evening, if I may. The documents that I've handed out has two options. Option number one is the photometrics that we have submitted, but with further clarifications in terms of the photometrics, in addition to being contoured, are shown in 5-foot increments. We believe that this lighting scheme meets IES standards. We feel comfortable with that. In the documents that I have submitted for further review, option number one indicates the actual photometrics that we have submitted, but in further details, in addition to the radius, we have 5-foot increments. And we, this does meet IES standards. Option number two would suggest raising the light poles from a 25-foot to 30 feet, which would increase the amount of illumination on the ground, as you can see from that. And if that would, if this is what the board would like to have, we would consider that. We're not in favor of that because we are in a residential zone and we would prefer a 25-foot light pole to be in keeping with the residential fabric. But a 30-foot pole would certainly increase the illumination levels, and we're open to your recommendations and suggestions on that. The other points that I think that Maureen brought were self-explanatory, and at this time we would be willing to answer any specific questions that you may have on the plans that were submitted. Thank you.
Whistle, Steve.
Can you install lower light poles, either say 15 feet tall, so that you have a chance of being screened behind vegetation, and still and put more of them in, and still have the same level of safety for the parking lot that you would accomplish with 25 or 30 foot poles?
I'm sure that could be arranged, but the reason we went this way is we do have a budget. If you remember the very first submission we had, we were planning on utilizing the existing light poles in the back of the parking lot. After further studies, we realized that those light poles were really not providing adequate lighting, and therefore we were asked by the parish to look at the possibility of having the lightings meet current codes. And that's where we came up with this as most economical fashion, and that's what our solution has been. We eliminated all the light poles in the back of the parking lot and have added these new fixtures to meet those standards.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery?
We haven't had a vote on completeness yet, have we?
Have we not? No.
Okay. I think it would be appropriate to deal with the issue of completeness, and then we can deal with the issues of whether or not the lighting is adequate.
I want to turn to the site plan review submission checklist, and we'll just go down it. I found that the quickest way to do this in the past is just go down 1 through 17, and if anybody has any questions, just stop me. Numbers 1, 2, and 3, I think, are pretty clear. Hearing nothing, we'll continue. 4, the lot line dimensions. 5 and 6, the location of existing buildings and structures and the proposed buildings and structures. Any concerns? Building setback, sideline, and rear yard distances. Number 8 is asked to be waived. Existing physical features on site within 200 feet of the site in a soil survey. Number 9, the topo. Number 10, parking. 11, the roads, curves, bumper, sidewalk details, sections, and dimensions. Twelve A, stormwater systems, it's going to remain the same, and sanitary waste disposal systems. 12B will remain the same, I believe. Water supply will remain the same. Solid waste storage and disposal. 14 is lighting that we were just talking about. I believe I skipped over 13, landscaping and buffering. Mr. Emery? Not this time?
Under substantive review, but
okay. Sign location and dimension is asked to be waived, and 16 technical and financial capability.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Sir?
Go right ahead. Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of St. Bartholomew's Church for site plan review of a building addition and parking lot expansion located at 8 Two Lights Row be deemed complete.
Do I have a second? Mr. Emery? Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Thank you. Yes, Nancy, go right ahead.
Under number three, on the discussion, on the last part of that paragraph, have you considered volunteering a pedestrian easement across the southern end of the lot to connect to the town open space?
I think that's
Have you discussed that decision?
The first time we saw that I saw it was when I received this Friday. It has not been considered, but it will be considered, and there's been no action on it. But there's it's not a negative comment. It's just something that needs to be followed up on. And the Diocese of Portland owns the property, and they would be they would make the decision on what to do with the property. And I can't speak for them, so that has to be presented to the diocese for disposition. Mm-hmm. And we can do that.
Okay.
Further discussion? Mr. Emery.
I assume what we're going to do is table this for a public hearing.
We're going to table it for a public hearing.
Prior to doing that, just any concerns the planning board may have that might help the applicant.
Please bring it up right now.
Generally, I like the plan very much. It may be helpful, as described in the planner's letter, to have a second set of landscaped islands, particularly if you're going to have another new pair of pole lights. I believe the plans indicate a landscaped island near the building, and then the islands that are farther away are only striped islands.
That's correct.
So I think that would be helpful, particularly where there's so much cleared asphalt there, and as the applicant is suggesting, they're not going to provide any additional detention for the stormwater, albeit the rate of increase is very little. With respect to the issue on lighting, I just happened to have gone through a major project in Falmouth, and this was one of the critical issues. The way it was described in Falmouth, they actually used taller lights, but I agree with, I think, the issue that was raised before. The lower light poles, 25 feet, would help to be more compatible with the residential neighborhood. The issue with lighting is bright spots and dark spots, and it's the relative level of lights. As one exits a building, one comes from a bright environment into a dark environment, and particularly in Cape Elizabeth, where everything tends to be very dark at night anyway, that can be quite dramatic, but I would prefer to see lower light poles and more of them, but I don't think maybe 16 feet is all right, but 20 feet certainly would be okay, and I really don't object to 25 feet. The issue is whether or not the source of the light is visible, and today what they're promoting is vertical lamps with flat lenses so the lenses don't project below the horizon, and then using side yard cutoffs or whatever. It may be because of the way the church functions work, that the entire parking lot isn't really used during nighttime hours. It may be that if you want to make the argument, for example, that you have adequate lighting with lower level lights for the spaces near the building, and I know you can't project for every instance where you might not have night lighting, but if that's the predominant situation, then I certainly would entertain that. But I was just calculating out the spacing on these lights, and they're actually 180 feet apart in one direction, and they're about 135 feet apart in the other direction. And typically, unless you go to taller lights, something on the neighborhood of 60 to 90 feet is fairly typical without getting into very bright fixtures. So I think it's going to be challenging to do this without going to higher poles. But I would prefer to see you keep it lower. And if you want to make an argument in terms of safety and what design criteria you're meeting. I don't mind that whatsoever. I don't have any personal need to see this place lit up like a department store parking lot. There's also discussion in terms of the on-street parking issue, and I think perhaps this road is perhaps a little more sensitive than most, but again, I don't have any objections whatsoever. We discussed the idea of shared parking earlier this evening, and we always talk about Easter Sunday. And unless every afternoon and every Sunday is Easter Sunday in this parking lot, I don't have objections to occasional need several times a year to use the roadway. There typically isn't a lot of traffic during the early morning weekend hours, so I think that's perhaps better than trying to fill additional wetlands, but ultimately it's your need that would determine how large the parking lot is and our ordinances. So other than that, I think it's going to be a nice addition to the church.
Just on a personal observation, I have a ongoing schedule that requires me to use the church's parking lot and meeting room on Wednesday evenings, and I've never found that parking lot to be an excessively dark parking lot.
And I think you'll find with this new lighting
scheme, the new it's going to be improved from what it is now.
Yeah.
There's no need to overlight it, I believe. Just any other concerns of the board?
Just for the record, did Mr. McNichol get recused on the record?
Yes.
You did, okay.
And if I may, Alice Allen, our board secretary, is at home recuperating from an injury, but she's working tonight taking minutes. So I just wanted to note to her, she may not have seen Mr. McNichols leave the podium. He did excuse himself from this item on the agenda tonight.
Okay.
A motion? Mr. Parkers?
Just one last quick question. Okay. Without unrolling the plans, and I've forgotten, are there still going to be the two entrances off of Broad Cove Road into the parking lot, or is there going to be a change in the traffic pattern?
No, the existing curb cuts will remain.
Okay, then I have a motion.
Right ahead, Mr. Parkhurst.
Be it further ordered that the application be tabled to the regular March 16th, 1999 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
Thank you, Nancy. Motion and second. Any further discussion? All those in favor signify by raising your right hand. It is unanimous. Thank you very much. I'm just going to thank you, Father. It would help.
Fire department, very responsive.
We were hoping for divine intervention.
I'm sure everyone.
Mr. Fitzpatrick, considering the noise, you want to give us 5 minutes to see if the fire department can shut this off, or you want to speak loud? Okay, you're the last item, and we're almost caught up, so we'll give them 5 minutes to see what they come up with.
Well, sure everyone's turned off TV, the TV planning board on TV. Can't stand it.
I've been asked by members of the audience for planning board members and applicants to speak directly into the microphone, and also our audio person has raised the volume so that members of our audience can hear. And if representatives of Fitzpatrick Associates would like to begin, the floor is yours. Just a test.
Dare I begin?
Go right ahead.
Mr. Chairman, good evening. We appreciate the board hearing us tonight. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with the firm of Sebago Technics. We're here tonight on behalf of Fitzpatrick Associates. With me tonight is Joel and Kelly Fitzpatrick, who are here to answer any questions you may have. We're here tonight for an amended subdivision review. This is for the Hemlock Hills subdivision, resource protection permit, and public access waiver. We'd like to take an opportunity to thank the board for indulging us on a couple of past occasions at some workshop meetings. We started this project, well, last summer, and have been working diligently to look at the site so we can come up with a design that's appropriate to it. At the workshop meetings, we discussed several issues surrounding access to the site, the status of the subdivision, wetlands. That was obviously an important item. And we think we've come up with a design that is appropriate to the site. The Fitzpatricks are excited about the opportunity to look at this site. Their goal would be to develop the houses on the site. I think at one of the workshop meetings, they actually passed out some sample designs of the character that they'd like to pursue in this subdivision. As included in your packet, this was a previously approved subdivision, Hemlock Hill subdivision. The town's attorney and the applicant's attorney had included some correspondence about the status of the subdivision in there, and I think we discussed that at the workshop meetings. The project is approximately 6.5 acres in size. The applicant is proposing 13 lots. I know your packet makes reference to 12 lots since the submittal. The applicant took a look at one of the lots, which was lot 5, in this area here. The applicant had combined those lots at one point and took a look at them for how a house might set on that. And those lots actually could work as they were originally shown on the original subdivision. So the applicant would like to amend his application to go to 13 lots. Originally, again, we had looked at that and he thought it might be better to combine them, but as we looked at it, did some grading plans, put some houses on it. He believes that he could have a 13th lot that would be very similar to the other lots. As part of the project, there would be approximately 760 linear feet of new roadway. There would be two street lights on it, one at the end of the turnaround and one at the entrance. And if I can walk over here to the board, I'll try to speak very loudly. The original subdivision plan had a road. Hemlock Hill was partially built down to about this point. The original subdivision plan had a right-of-way and a road that was going to come all the way through here, coming out onto Oakhurst Road. When we began looking at the site back in, I believe it was June of last year, we looked at the site for just building this roadway, taking the original subdivision and building it out as it was shown. A couple things happened since the original approval, and I guess it was approved twice by the planning board, once in 1964 and again in 1972. The town's wetland regulations went through a change. Actually, the town adopted wetlands regulations. And what that did was, is when we mapped the wetlands, Mark Hampton of our office spent considerable time on the site a number of times going back and forth out there. And there's a report in your packet that identifies the wetlands and describes the general area. But we mapped a couple areas, one area that was an RP1 wetland, and that required a 100-foot setback. Because of that 100-foot setback, there was now a section of what would have been the road that would come within that.